Hi YouTube, and welcome back to another installment of my life in the woods, I guess. I really need to come up with a name for this channel at some point, and I really need to prop my camera up a little better, so let's pop a Sharpie under there. Does that work? Maybe just a tad higher. Yeah, that's not so bad. So today we are going to be making arrows. Okay, so to do arrows, I'm going to need a short list of supplies, which I don't have on me right now, but lucky for you, I have a very tiny house, and it's very easy to find supplies, so let me get them real quick. Alright, this is a bundle of weeds. I chopped the tops off of them. And these have been drying out in my shed for a couple weeks. Alrighty, so this is what the weeds look like when they dry. The one that I'm using for the thing. Sorry, this is blurry. But there are these tall things, and they've got these little leaves running all the way down them that are green when they're big, and then they bloom out to these big branched flower heads. It's kind of like a little forest tree. Might have a green one over here somewhere. All the other ones that are growing right now are goat's beard. One like this. Haven't tried that one. There's one on the ground. I'm not really sure about the species. Actually, that'd make a pretty good stave. But that's kind of what they look like when they're green. Odd looking little leafies, and of course my This is basically when these little stemmy plants dry, they turn very, very woody. Now, because of that structure, they're also pretty flexible, pretty bendy. They're super easy to bend. You can overbend them when you're straightening, so we're going to talk about being a little bit careful with that. But the main goal here is going to be to keep the fat end as much as possible, because an arrow made out of this material, we want it to be fairly light. Now we're adding strength automatically because the grain that's running down the arrow, this is not being put on a lathe. All these little fibers that hold this together are actually also good for making thread, so they're pretty darn strong. In fact, if you get done stripping this thing and you add a layer of epoxy or any kind of glue to the outside, it'll help hold those fibers together better. And I may do that at some point, but most of this is a proof of concept. So there are a couple things we want to look at. Straightness is not a huge important. You can see if I twist that, it's bouncing up and down. So looking down this, it's going to need to be straightened. And we can do a little bit of that with some heat and just gentle plying. If you've got a spot like on the end here where it's just all wanky and might be easier to see looking down it, it's just got that big long gouge on the end. There's a big bend in it right here, and then it twists back. That's probably going to have to be removed. So we're going to start by cutting this, and I'm basically going off the fat end. And to cut it, I'm going to use a hacksaw because it makes a very gentle cut. And I want to try and be pretty close to straight, but perfect straightness is not important. And what I'm going to do is just do a couple light cuts and then rotate. And then another couple light cuts and rotate. I'm going to have a lot of sawdust to clean up later, apparently. And I'm trying not to apply any pressure at all if I can, and then we'll just kind of line these guys up. Now, you may think that this end of the stick would be a great place to put the nock of the arrow, right? And the nock would be the back of the arrow. Put it on the fat end where it's going to absorb all the shock. So now I've got it gilded, I'm all the way around it, and I'm just gonna, now I can get a little more aggressive and hack through, or I could snap it off with my fingers if I wanted to, and I don't have to worry about breaking those strong outer fibers off here. But I'm gonna have to get a nice clean cut running through it first, which I don't seem to be able to do. Draw this back one more time and see if I can get him to cut kind of half-ass clean. Nope, so we'll just flip them over right here, screw it. Doesn't want to cut there either. Thank you, Nuggie. There we go. Come on. And at this point, this thing is pretty much busted to hell, so just go ahead and break that off and you can get a nice clean cut. Now I'm going to try and adjust the camera here so you can see. Oops, wrong direction. That might be too close. But you can probably see it's real woody on the inside. It's not that's not what you would necessarily expect, which is basically a ball of pith with some fibers around it. So this is actually, and in these short lengths, you can really feel it. Like, it's pretty stiff and strong for being such a weak little weed. I mean, you could push this down by blowing on it, but once you get them to size, they're pretty stiff and strong. So what I was saying is, you would think this end would be, the fat end would be good for the knock, and you want the skinny end where the point is, right? Wrong. So I don't have any arrows to make flights out of right now, which means my arrows need to be flightless. And there's probably a couple people that will sit back and be like, oh, this guy's an idiot, you can't make a flightless arrow, it has to have a flight. Or maybe some other people that are intrigued by that. But the concept behind stability of flight is very, very, very simple, okay? As long as your center of mass is ahead of your center of pressure for any object, then the object is going to fly true and straight with the center of mass leading the center of pressure. So even if you took this stick and just cut it off at each ends and threw it sideways really, really hard, in the wind it would stabilize and the heavy end would come around to face forward eventually. Now, something this light's probably going to do this number and kind of wobble and weeble around, and without the flights to add stabilization, it's not going to lock in right away. But the point is, you launch this from an arrow and it's going to stay straight and true. Now, can't prove that to you right now because I lost my other arrow, but maybe a little shot of the bow at the end of this video will do. And I totally just made a crunch because I'm bending this around too much, so if that's too close to this end, then I'm gonna have to chop it off. Next thing is gonna be length. So when I draw back, I basically have my arm out all the way extended, and wherever my fingers are gripping back here, like, that's gonna be the natural length that I want to cut the arrow at. And I want to cut it a little bit further than that. So this is where you determine it. So you get the other end cut off where it's nice and strong, and then you come back on this end and you just cut your, that went almost straight through it. That was easy. And then you've got a length, and then you check the length again because it's too short. And this is probably, actually, I think I botched this one, it's too short. But in either way, I can use this as a measuring stick to cut the other pieces. So right now I'm gonna take all these sticks behind me and I'm gonna cut them down on the fat end. Now, because of this little thing, basically we're gonna put a ferrule on each end of the arrow with the sewing thread, and probably lock it down with glue or something to weight it, so your balance point is automatically going to be a little forward of the center line. Like, this is almost maybe 3/5 of the way down the shaft, so the heavy end over here is around 30% shorter than the light end over here. And your center of pressure, since this is almost the same size all the way down, you've got a lot more skin on this back end for air resistance and drag. So if I fire this with the knock at the skinny end, this is automatically going to fly straight and true. Now, there are a couple things you can do to improve this concept, and both of them are done with modern arrows. Number one is the arrowhead itself acts as a weight, so that shifts your center of balance or your center of mass forward along the arrow shaft, which adds stability. Okay, and we're going to be putting a broadhead on one of these, which this is a little aluminum broadhead. This is just a proof of concept, and that's going to add just a little bit of weight to the front. And if you add flights to the back and they're sufficiently light, then you're going to leave your center of mass about where it is, but you're going to draw your center of pressure far back down the arrow, because those flights are increasing the drag and that affects the center of pressure drastically. Okay, so the key to an arrow flying straight, number one, is the point of the arrow needs to be aligned with the tail of the arrow, and that's going to be your distance of travel. So as long as you've got it semi-straight and it's aligned with that plane, it'll fly stable. And the other thing is to have your center of mass ahead of your center of pressure. You can do this by adding weight to the front or by adding drag to the back. Most arrows utilize this concept by doing both, because they start with a blank, perfect cylindrical shaft that's not weighted on either end. So in modern arrows, it has to be that way. Like, you need flights to draw the drag back, and a heavier broadhead will help you push the weight forward. So you're using a steel broadhead on an aluminum shaft with little nylon flights that don't weigh anything. Of course, it's going to fly straight and true every time, and you've got a perfect shaft. But in primitive survival in the wilderness, you don't have perfect aluminum shafts growing out of the ground, so you got to use what's available, be it sticks or dried out weeds or whatever. And so that's the principle that we're going to go with. And I've already tested this numerous times. I started by putting a blunted nail in the front of the last one that I made to test it. Flew straight, perfect, and dead on target. I just need some more modification of my bow to adjust my aim by putting an arrow rest on it. But other than that, that's all you need to know, and that's the science behind, stable flight. And anybody who dabbles in model rockets knows this. I mean, it becomes instinctive at some point. So, I'm going to shut the video down, I'm going to cut these guys to length, and then we'll start making some barrels. Alright, so I got my arrows cut off, and I've got a fag of kindling in here, and I've got five staves, and there's actually more drying outside that are, those are drying in the grass, so they're kind of going through a rennet process, so they may or may not work for this. So real quick, the next stape of this is these tiny little hairs on these on the shafts here from the weed are not really ideal. They're definitely not aerodynamic. So I'm going to shave those guys off with my knife. There it is. So the one thing from SOG that hasn't pissed me off yet. And all I'm going to do is basically just hold my knife perpendicular to it and run it down the blade. I don't even have to look at it. Just run down there, all the way around it, all the way up and down. You can draw it back or forward. And for this, since it's such a delicate thing and I don't want to hurt the fibers, I'll actually angle the knife slightly toward the back of the knife, slightly toward the direction I'm going. So I'm actually cutting with the back of the blade with whatever kind of burr is on the end of here, a little micro burr from sharpening or whatever, which theoretically shouldn't be there, but in either case it still works, even with a good sharp knife. If you angle it too much, you're just going to be sliding over it, so you want to go 90 degrees, and then just, usually 90 will work. You can go a little less or a little forward, and this is basically just a tedious, long, slow process, but when you're done, you kind of smooth out this area a little bit, and if you run your fingers up, you'll feel the roughness here, and then when you get to that slick spot, it'll feel a lot smoother. I like to do that just to take this off, because these little stickies can get in your fingers or wherever else, and they definitely don't help any characteristic of flight, because it adds to skin drag. So ideally would be to take a piece of sandpaper and just rough it down, and you can do that too. Take like some 120 grit sandpaper maybe, and just really, really lightly scuff the whole surface and smooth it out. Ideally, you'd want to wet this down with some kind of oil, but we're not going to go through all of that. So I am going to scrape these off, I promise. For right now, this one's kind of hard to tell what the front and the back is. The back on this one's actually kind of flattened out. So as long as... Now, the problem is, if I set this on the ground and just pop my hand on top here and push down a little bit, you'll see a natural flex to the arrow. Now, that can be changed and altered by heating it up and during the straightening process. So I think I'm going to try that with this because I don't want to cut along the narrow end. This end's already plenty narrow enough for a knock. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to score this down about maybe 3/4 of an inch. Score that in, and I'm just putting the point of my knife into the wood and just pushing with my thumb toward the end, not digging real deep. So I'll score that side, and I'm making 2 score marks that are about maybe a little more than 1/8 of an inch apart, and then I'll come over on the other side and do the same thing. Now, of course, I'm gonna rough sand these in place with my knife before I go any further, but I just figured I'd go ahead and show this part now. And this stave is probably gonna end up getting tossed in the trash anyways. But now what I've done effectively is made a spot that I can kind of cut out. So kind of dig down in between these to make a weak spot. I don't want to put too much pressure on this, run the knife right through my hand. That won't do me any good. And then you can apply a little more pressure from the outside, just like you would wedge with an axe or something, and just kind of negotiate that guy down in there. Now with a hardwood stave, this is probably going to be a little bit more complicated, but with these guys, it's pretty easy. You just want to make sure you don't split everything open, because that would be devastating. So now the back is essentially cut, and what I've found is if I've done my score marks correctly, I can just lift, see that? Ooh, wrong way. I can just kind of lift these sections out of the end of the wood, and they'll just lift out like that. And when I lift them both out, so just lift on this side, do the same thing. That one's a little bit shorter. Then I can go ahead and run my knife down here to, I want the fibers cut off. I don't want them hanging around in there where they shouldn't. And that side needs to go a bit deeper. So this is basically just like doing any kind of woodworking project, really. I mean, if you're scoring like mortise and tenon joints or anything of that sort. Yeah, that didn't go anywhere near my mark. Go ahead and push my mark in there a bit deeper. Now, one thing this is going to do is it's going to weaken the back of this, which is why we're going to need a ferrule on the back to hold everything together. Whereas with a better wood, you probably wouldn't need a ferrule at all. Yeah, and I might have to get in there with something pointy and kind of dig that guy out. But I think you get the general idea. You're just going to basically lift out these two side pieces. And you can use your thumb, or you can wrap it with some kind of weight or hold it with a plier to keep it from breaking all the way down. And what you end up with is a nice little knock on the back. Now with this one, I've got to be super careful because I wasn't going with the natural bend of the wood. You want this knock to be lined up where the bow bends this way or this way. If the knock's turned like this and it's bending across it, that's not good. And the reason for that is when you knock your arrow in the bow, you want the arrow's naturally going to flex, and you want it to flex away from the bow stave and toward your offhand. So if I'm shooting this like this, I want the flex to come toward me. That way the arrow is not rubbing up against the bow as it's going down. Like, it flexes away, and then as it flexes back, it's clearing the front of the bow, so you get as little influence from the bow as possible, and this is just following the guideline of the string wherever you aimed it as much as possible. Now on the front, we're basically going to do the same thing. Now I said I started with nails before, and basically all I did was I dug a little spot out with my fingernail, and I took a nail and just drove it into the stave with my thumb. Well, this end's going to crack and it's going to split open. So if you wrap that then with a suitably strong thread or find some other way to make a ferrule, which is just a strengthened point at the end. All these fibers are still intact. They're still running all the way down the length of the stick. So you basically are trying to prevent a weak point here that would end up splitting all the way down the bow, shattering this thing when it comes out of the bowstring and running into your arm. And that said, if you screw yourself up with a self bow, don't blame me, because I'm going to tell you right now, this is not a safe activity. It is not something for those who are young or inexperienced. And I'm pretty much inexperienced, but you know, if I kill myself, it'd be funny. If you do it, I'll get in trouble. So I'm gonna go ahead and make this point in this video right now. This is not a safe method of making arrows, more like a last ditch kind of effort. And if you are going to do it, make sure you have proper safety equipment in place to protect your arm, your hand, everything, like a good, really thick protection for this part of your arm is probably ideal, because if the sucker snaps, it's sending splinters, and if those splinters go, they're gonna dig, and then if you don't get to a hospital, they're gonna get infected and they're gonna cause problems, not to mention if they cut one of your little arteries on your arm or something. So danger, danger. So now we can get on with the show, now that I've clarified that point. Like, what you do is your responsibility. These videos are for educational purposes only, is what I'm trying to say. But I'm going to try and cover some of these points in detail, so if you are dumb enough to repeat what I do, then, you know, you're taking responsibility for any damage that comes to your person. Anyways, time to shut down the camera again and basically take the little knife, go out on the porch, smoke a cigarette, drink some full throttle energy drink, and just shave these suckers down. Doesn't really take very long, but I like to do a clean job, so I'll probably sit and fiddle with them. I may not even finish tonight and just pick up the video tomorrow or something, but it's a boring part, and I've already bored you enough with the science of flightless arrows. So okay, so kind of hurting a little bit, because somewhere along the line the last couple days I did something on one of my ribs. I think I got a bruise on it. I'm not sure what caused it, but I wanted to go out chopping this morning, and figured, it's not hurting too bad. Well, starting to regret that decision. Anyways, I've got all my sticks kind of cleaned up. Once you get in a rhythm with the stroking of the knife, you just want to use really, really light strokes. In actuality, you can use any rough piece of sandstone for this, and it will probably work just fine. I actually have a block of sandstone that I'm trying to flatten. I didn't pull it out, but that would be like a Neolithic kind of application for it. And the more you kind of carve around on these little end bits, the more you'll find out that a tiny little sharp piece of quartz work just as good as any knife. I mean, that's just the way it is. Using a rock fragment, they allow you to get in there and do kind of precise work without, you know, with at least as much clumsiness as this. So these two pieces, the ends on them are kind of smaller than I want, and this one's got a crack in it. It had a crack in it before I even carved the knock on it, so I think I'm going to set those little boogers off to the side. Alright. Or maybe chop them up and add them to the little pile of short pieces that I got from cutting these. So that leaves me with three kind of rock steady pieces. I've cut notches in these. I don't know if the camera, I got it on autofocus, so I'm not sure if it'll do it or not, but let's see. Alright, maybe. I don't know. It's not working. But I've got some little knocks cut, and they're each one's about a little bit bigger than an eighth. And these two, unlike our original, are actually lined up with the flex of the natural flex of the wood fibers. So when you apply pressure, it's gonna bow out a certain way, and you wanna curve these, like, this slot has to be cut 90 degrees to that. That way when you release the bowstring, it goes and it bends away from the bow stave. So we're gonna go about wrapping a couple of these. This guy, the pointed one, I'm not gonna worry about right now, because I'm gonna show you this technique as quickly and efficiently as I can. Take your thread and wrap it around like this. Ugh. And you basically want to make it to where these are almost like a knot. So just push that through there, just like you were tying the first knot on your shoelaces or whatever. Actually, I want this to go over the top. So what we're going to do is make our knot kind of in situ, as it were. So you want to leave enough thread dangling here that you'll have something to tie off with at the end, which is how I normally do it. I'm going to try a slightly different technique today. So just wrap it once, and then I'm going to curve this, the little dangly thread. I'm going to run that down the blade. And actually, we may want to go ahead and tie a knot here. I think I've got this backwards. I don't know. Or you can wrap it twice. You basically just want something where the string is kind of held tightly, so that you can loop this back around it without pulling it totally loose. But this will work for now. Screw it. So however you want to suture it, but the main thing is the thread's going to hold itself in place. So this little knot's going to become unimportant real quick. So just wrap that, curl that around a couple times so you can hold it steady. And then start wrapping your thread by rotating your arrow. And then as soon as you wrap it once or twice, it's going to grip this little dangle end. So this isn't coming loose anymore. Okay, so then we can continue to wrap it around. And if you're twisting the whole arrow as opposed to trying to work around this with the spool, it's much, much easier. And this might also be easier if you just tack this end piece down with some glue. It should be fine. And you don't really have to wrap this a lot. The key is you want to wrap it kind of tight, and you want to start your twist above the bottom of the knot, so the string's actually going to be touching this thread as opposed to touching the arrow itself, and it's going to be pushing on the thread, so the thread grabs the stick and forces it down the bow instead of having a straight wood to wood, you know, where you're putting compression directly on a soft piece of wood. And so once you got a couple wraps on this, it should be good enough to tie off. Now the way I normally do this, and the way I'll probably end up doing this on the video because I'm not familiar with this other knot so well, is I will pull down some tension on this piece of string here, and that's going to kind of set everything in place nice and tight, and then I'll actually just tie a knot here and be done with it. When I do the other ones, I'm actually probably just going to do my original thing where I just tie the two threads together in a knot, but I wanted to try this because it's kind of neat and interesting. So now I'm going to clip off this excess here. And I actually have a pair of jewelry cutters that would let me clean this up a little better. But anyways, so what you dug, the main idea here is you just want a tight wrap of thread around this deal here. And what that's going to do is just sort of hold everything together. It's going to keep the wood from wanting to splinter and fray once pressure is applied here. And if we apply it to a bowstring, or just take a USB cord, and if that's small enough, which it's not, then it's not going to flex. But when the string's pushing on it, it's not going to have a tendency to splinter like it normally would. Okie dokie. So that's how you tie a ferrule. I tie one at this end, and then I'm going to do kind of a blunted end on the other end. Now the center of this thing is all pith, so you can drill this out. Actually, would probably work better that way rather than doing it this way, because this is going to cause the wood to split almost definitely. But sometimes that pith is not so bad, and this is actually a pretty strong shaft, so it's looks like it's going to end up working. And I'm just going to seat that nail in there like that. And that nail's going to act as like a field head, just a practice head, sort of. But I'm also going to wrap this end, that, clip this, tighten this guy down, I'm gonna probably pull it this way a little bit just to tighten it. And then I like to just tie a knot because it's easy. Roll it to the right. I don't know what my over is. I forgot. Anyway, just tie a nice tight little knot there. Snip off these ends. If you want to get a really good knot, what you can also do is tie a regular knot on either one of those ends and then just shove it down where it's up against the knot that you have, and that'll act as a stop knot and just kind of hold everything in place. But for these, I have another plan, actually. So this is wood glue. You can use super glue or epoxy or anything else that you want to use. And what I'm going to do is just put a little bit on here. Just dab him on. You don't need a whole lot, just a little bit. And just roll that around the threads with my finger, let it get in between the threads. Now the main point of this glue is to hold the threads together and hold the knot down, not to look pretty. So if you want pretty, epoxy might be a better bet, but good luck smearing that around, smearing super glue around with your fingers and not sticking to your arrow. Just do a little bit of that, and that'll kind of bind those threads up, and it'll just hang on to them. And at that point, our arrow is ready to go. Alrighty, here we are. And this is my bow stave. As you might or might not be able to tell from the picture, I've cut like a little arrow shelf into the end here. So still not completely done, but that seems to be good enough to increase the accuracy. Basically, I want the string when it's tight to be behind that notch so that the bow stave itself isn't interfering with the flight of the arrow too much. And over here I've got a wood pile and a little deal with some holes in it, because I already pretty much I just wanted to test these first, make sure they weren't going to explode on camera. I have not tested the pointy arrow yet. But speaking of exploding on camera, one of my arrows did not fare so well on test firing. So when I found it in the grass over there after a bounce out, it had some splintering on the end. So I just did a quick pressure check from the back and it basically fell apart. So that would have been completely shattered the next time I tried to fire it. So it's a good thing I didn't. The other one did fairly well. I don't see any cracks in it, any obvious stress. And this was also the one that I weakened with that little crunch, if I include that part of the straightening video. And this one is as yet untested. And this is the one with the little metal point on it. Now, I suck at archery. I have absolutely no experience with this. So I've set up a little log here that's 15 feet or about 5 yards from the target. And we're going to see how this little guy does. We on? Yep, we're on. Okie dokie. This is, it's just basically a pant leg of an old pair of jeans that's even more tore up than these. And I just basically made a little sleeve protector out of it real quick. Just a string here on the end that I can cinch up. And wrap this a couple times, tie it down here on the end near my wrist, and hopefully if the bow snaps on me, this will protect my arm from getting popped with a bowstring. I haven't done much on here. I haven't done a video about the bow yet, and my back's still bothering me, so I can't use my push-pull method to string this, but I can still string it this way. As you can see, it's made out of oak, and it has taken a set already, but it hasn't set any further yet, so I'm not overly concerned with that. Get my butt in here so I can do this without hurting my
my rib. That's been bugging me. And on this end is basically, there's a Boyer's knot tied in it. And on this end, I've got a loop, which I spent all day because I didn't have any beeswax trying to twist this thread and get it to cooperate. And it finally did. And I don't know what the pull weight is. I haven't measured it, but I also haven't gotten any video or shots of me drawing it back yet, so that might actually, just to get an idea, I can kind of see how bad my tillering job is on the video, maybe. But yeah, it's just a simple bow, carved from a stave, shaved down. I haven't oiled it yet, haven't done much to it, but that's not the point. Point is, will I hit the target? I'm going to try my regular point here. Now, this is one of the arrows we drove the nails in, and I don't know if you can see it or not, but when it hit that back stop of wood, it basically just drove that nail into the end here. No splits, and that sucker's in there, so getting that out's going to be a problem if I decide to change the point up. But essentially, the arrow worked as planned. Between that blunt point and these little wraps, it kept everything from falling apart. And I noticed my other pointy arrow is a little bit crooked, but before this bow sets anymore, I'm going to go ahead and fire this guy off. Now, I'm only going to take one shot on the video. It's basically just a demonstration to make sure this works. And what I'm doing now is testing the flex. Like I told you, you put a colored arrow or something on there so I can see what direction needs to be facing out towards me, so that the arrow flexes under stress, it'll flex away from the bow and then snap back into place when it clears the bow before it hits the target. Oh, and it's not sticking on my string very well all of a sudden. But all right, back, stop killing me. I did not see where that hit. I think I flinched, because there were already three holes in there, weren't there? I don't know. It's alright. A little more stress testing never hurt anybody. It was this side. Go ahead and go there. Get my string out of the way. Get on there. I saw where that one hit. A little high and a little left. And the arrow is laying back there in the grass. So same thing with this. Just kind of test it, see what direction I want to go. What's more this way. Yeah, it's still flexing right in line with it. So I'll just turn that end up. And maybe that'll flex it out and away a bit. It's not the best arrow in the world, but low and left. And we didn't hit. And my broad point totally failed to stay in the arrow shaft. Now, part of this is because I did this in a quick, speedy manner. It didn't have much of a tang to put on it, so I wasn't really, I don't know what I was expecting. I was kind of expecting it to try and bury it in there or maybe stick in the wood, and it possibly is. I just can't see it. But yeah, that's gone. But as you can see, the principal idea works. I mean, if we were to replace these nails with like a pointed piece of bone, like these would be perfectly suitable for hunting as long as I get my aim down. Which, like I said, I am not an archer. Where did the arrow go? And that last one about popped me in the face because I was too close to it. But I'm brave, so we're going to go ahead and try this guy again. Booyah. High and left. There you have it. I'm going to step over here so I'm out of the sunlight. I can't hit the broadside of a barn, but I'm sure with a little bit of practice I could probably get better. And since it's still mainly going to the left, I might have to shave down that bow a little bit more to to get the shaft aligned with center where it's not deflecting as much, but it's definitely doing something. So work on my aim, work on my bowyer technique, but these arrows are essentially ready to go. And even though it's a short distance, I mean, I hope you realize this is not like these arrows are flying straight, you know, to the point where it hit here, bounced off of that piece of wood that's behind there, and bounced almost straight back towards me, flipping in the air as it came at me, where it was about vertical like this. When it, you know, it was kind of, when it bounced out, it flipped like this, and it landed with the heavy side down, just as expected, because that's following the rules of flight. You know, the heavy end's going to lead the light end. So the theory definitely works. You don't need to have fletching to make an arrow fly straight. I would prefer fletching because it's used as a damper, but it's not 100% necessary if you construct the arrow right. Now I need to take my bowstring down, so I don't know if you can see me or not, and I don't care. I gotta get this thing off of here. Because on a self bow, or on any bow that's not a compound bow, if you leave your bow strung, then the wood's going to take more of a set, and eventually it's going to lose its springiness over time. And this still needs to be oiled too, so I need to get it back inside before it starts drying out too much. But not bad for a quick job with the self bow and some arrows.